Again, welcome to Point Blank. Today we're here with State Comptroller, Mr. H. Carl McCall.
Chris, good to be with you. It's a pleasure to be here in Buffalo. Always great to be here.
Nice having you. Mm-hmm. What brings you here to Buffalo?
Well, several things. This evening I'm going to be the keynote speaker at Group Ministries. It's the 10th anniversary banquet. This is an important program for the Buffalo community because it's a group of churches and social agencies working together to address very important issue, providing services. For instance, the AIDS epidemic. This is a group of church people who don't run away, but face up to the fact that this is a very serious problem in the African American community.
Sure.
And right now, people don't pay attention because we hear a lot of the statistics and we hear about new medical treatments. Yeah. And in some communities, we've seen a significant decrease. But at the same time, we've seen a very significant increase in cases of AIDS in the African American community.
Sure.
And this is a group that reaches out and counsels people and provides treatment and services to victims. At the same time, through education, tries to help people to avoid the possibility of becoming a victim of AIDS. They have educational programs and other social services. So I'm here to speak to the Group Ministries and to celebrate with them 10 years of important service in Buffalo. I'm also going to be over in Niagara Falls today for a youth rally.
Okay.
Young people are coming together to talk about the serious tragedy that we've experienced in New York City. I have an apartment in New York City not far from the Trade Center. I have visited that site, and it's just indescribable. But think about what this is saying to our children. Our children feel frightened. They feel insecure. You know, this is always a country where we thought nothing would happen to us. We're big and powerful.
Right.
Terrorism and these events happen to other people in other places. Well, now we see that they've happened to us right at the very center of the most active part of our state. And we have to reassure our children that we're going to do everything possible to make sure that they're secure, that these things don't happen in their communities.
Yeah, that was, where were you?
I was on 27th Street, and I was about to leave to go to vote. That was election day.
Yeah.
And, of course, all that was disrupted, and since then, everything has changed. And well, I flew up here today. It took a little bit longer to get on the plane, but I didn't mind. You know, think it's going to be inconvenient for a while,
right.
But we've got to accept that because we have to really be much more mindful of the need to have good security everywhere.
Yeah, I remember seeing that. I had gotten home from work at 4:30 in the morning.
I see. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I looked at Pete, and I waited around 10 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
I saw the second plane crash into the building, World Trade Center building, and it was like watching some sort of science fiction.
Well, see, we thought that would never happen in America.
Yeah,
that was a very, very interesting sight to think, see this plane coming, to think, to say, when are they going to protect us?
Yeah.
We have never felt so vulnerable.
Yeah.
Well, we are vulnerable, and we've got to make sure that we overcome that and that we have the kind of protection that's necessary.
Sure. Now, for those of you in the audience, of course, you all know that Mr. McCall is running for governor. And I think it's high time that we have a black governor.
Well, I think the important thing is that we have a governor who is qualified,
sure,
has the experience, and has a commitment to work with all of the people of the state to meet all their needs.
Okay.
And the important things that we have to do in the state is provide a first-class education for all of our children.
Right.
Unless we prepare our children for the sophisticated kind of jobs that are going to be available in the future, that New York will be a second-class state if we don't do that. We've got to make sure people have good health care, that our senior citizens have affordable quality health care, and that they don't have to make decisions about whether they're going to spend their money to buy prescription drugs or pay for groceries. So we've got to make prescription drugs available at a reasonable cost to our senior citizens.
Right. Now, your current position, of course, is as state controller. A lot of people, especially myself, we don't exactly know what their position is about, but I think it has to be in relation to
the money. That's right. I'm in charge of the money. I've got, as the chief fiscal officer of the state, as controller, I do several things. I pay all the state's bills, and I issue the state's debt, and I'm the chief auditor of the state. I send people out to make sure wherever taxpayer money is being spent, it's being spent well. And I manage the state's pension fund. I'm the sole trustee of the state's pension fund. I invest the pension fund in businesses and in affordable housing programs and other ways to help the economy. But I look out for all the public employees in the state, all the retirees, all the people who work for the city, the county, people who work in the state, people who work in nonprofit agencies. Those people are in my pension system, and my job is to make sure when they retire that they have a decent retirement. And just this past year, we had a real victory. We gave all public employees in the state something called a COLA, a cost of living adjustment. So now when you retire, as the cost of living goes up, your pension benefits will go up. So those are the things that I have done so far as the controller. But I put money into our communities to provide jobs and economic opportunities and benefits to people.
Right.
And having had the kind of experience as the controller and the chief fiscal officer of the state, a job that, as you know, I was elected to do. I was elected statewide twice. I have also been the president of the New York City Board of Education. I've been a state senator. I've been an ambassador to the United Nations. I spent 8 years at Citibank in the private sector. Mm-hmm. So I think I have a unique set of experiences that really will prepare me for the big job of being governor.
So that's what prompted you to think that in order to take that next step, being governor, your experience?
It's in my experience and my record, what I've been able to do for people as the state controller.
Sure.
One of the things I did, for instance, is the pension system. I more than doubled the pension system. When I took over the pension system, we had about $56 billion. It's now grown to about $115 billion.
Sure.
And that means that I've saved taxpayers a lot of money because they no longer have to contribute to the pension system. And I have been able to help all of our municipalities by my auditors going out working with the city, the state, with the county, with local governments, helping them manage their money better and therefore provide better services to taxpayers.
Sure.
So I've got a record in terms of what I've been able to do for people in New York, and I've got the experience that nobody else has in New York. So therefore, I think that I've got a very good opportunity to become our next governor.
Yeah, you're
awesome.
It's pretty tight. It must have been like a year and a half ago.
About a year ago. We've got another year to go. So you have to start early. One of the things you got to do, you got to raise a lot of money.
Right.
In order to be governor. The election will be a year from now. It'll be a primary in September of 2002. So I've got another year. And spending a lot of time here in Western New York and other places, talking to people, developing support. And I'm very pleased to have support of a lot of people here in Buffalo, and I think over the next month we'll get even more.
Sure. Do you have any idea where you are in the polls, or is it too early?
It's much too early, and these times, over with the election a year away, polls don't tell you very much. I would say, 6 months from now, so we'll start looking at polls, and we might get some real indication of how we're doing.
Right. Now, what do you see yourself as bringing to the table? What do you feel you're bringing to the table that maybe George Pataki isn't?
Well, George Pataki, as you know, has been governor for 6.5 years, and the thing is, what has he brought to the table? What is the economy in Western New York? I mean, we got high unemployment, and what is George Pataki offering Western New York? Some Indian gambling casinos. Is that going to solve the economic problems in Western New York? How many people are going to go to these casinos?
Yeah.
How many people are going to be hired at these casinos? How much money? There's a casino in downtown Buffalo. What percentage of those proceeds are going to go to the city of Buffalo? What's it going to cost Buffalo to have a casino here? I'm not against the casino here, but I think we've got to really challenge the government and say, show us what it's going to do for us. And so, that's the real issue, is that we've had the governor for 6.5 years, almost 7 years now, and we aren't any better off. In fact, in some ways, our economy is beginning to slip. Things are not as good as they used to be.
See, now Buffalo has a long history of being completely lagged behind the country, especially even the state, as far as the economy is concerned. And we're so down, just look at it from the standpoint of a guy who was born and raised here and spent most of his life here. I'm thinking they said casino. I'm like, well, at least people be working.
Well, fine, I'm not against the casino, but I think we got to offer a little more than that.
I know what you're saying.
They got to offer us more than just a casino as the sole thing to turn things around.
It shouldn't be the anchor of the community.
When I talk about Buffalo, I spend a lot of time here, and I know what's needed. We need real jobs and companies. We've got to go out and use the resources of the state to encourage companies to come here. We've got to give companies incentives and tax breaks if they'll come to Buffalo and provide real jobs, and if they make a commitment to stay here. And let me tell you, for me, Western New York, Buffalo would be a real priority. There are a lot of good, hardworking people here who want to make a contribution, and we've got to help them do it. The saddest thing I hear is from people here in Western New York who say, look, I raised my kids here, I sent them to school, and then when they finished, they went somewhere else because they don't think they're going to get a job here. You know, families are breaking up. We've got to keep families together, and we've got to let young people know that they can stay here in Western New York and that there are going to be jobs for them. That's going to be a real priority for me.
Well, now, from the standpoint of somebody who wasn't raised in Baltimore, raised in Buffalo, what do you see as being the cause of such a low economy? What's preventing us? We all know what it is, what's there. What's preventing us from moving on?
A neglect. We haven't had people in Albany where these decisions are made who are really committed to Western New York and willing to help. We put our resources into other places and it's made a difference. We've got to put resources. The state has got to really say, look, if we're going to spend X number of dollars on economic development, give incentives and tax breaks, let's give the majority of those incentives and tax breaks to the area with the greatest need. And what's the area with the greatest need? It's Western New York.
Okay. Folks, blacks here want to see also a reduction in prisons and an increase in schools, particularly colleges, rivers like this, where affirmative action, of course, the colleges has been attacked the most. What do you plan to do?
Well, I believe in our college system, particularly the state university system. You've got Buffalo State here, you've got the SUNY at Buffalo, and they have had opportunity programs. Assemblyman Arthur Eve, as you know, the deputy speaker, has been one of the leading advocates and somebody who really has developed all of these opportunity programs so that students from minority communities, African American, Latino students, can go to these colleges and get the kind of assistance, because when they do, they get out there people who can make a contribution. I mean, we should look at higher education as an investment. You know, if we're willing to invest in our colleges and our universities and provide programs and scholarship assistance to help students, those students will end up coming out, not going to prison, which is going to cost us to incarcerate them, but if we educate people rather than incarcerate them, those people end up being economic providers. They become economic leaders. They contribute. And as a result of that,